Good morning, friends. Welcome to Church Online. Would you please join us as we worship our great God in song?
Holding up the head. Of our Marsden Park Church. It's wonderful that you can join us today. And today we have a guest with us, Lionel Windsor. And Lionel will be opening God's Word with us really soon and speaking on the topic of environmental care. Often when we come to these topics, there's one side or the other when we think about our world outside. And often, what God wants to say on particular topics is drowned out by those who are for or against something. But today we're going to hear clearly what God says, and we're going to hear what God says in both the Old and New Testaments. I'm really looking forward to what Lionel has to say really, really soon. How about I pray and I'll invite Ruth then up to do the wonderful kid spot. Let me pray. Father God, we do thank you so much that we can come together today as your church. Yes, we look forward to the time where we can physically gather once again, but we know even in our homes, your spirit is with those who trust in you. Your spirit is helping to point us to your Son, Jesus. Your Spirit is helping us to hear your words clearly. Hear your words sung, hear your words prayed, read in the Scriptures and preached. Father God, we thank you, though we are sitting in living rooms and elsewhere, you are still with us. You are still guiding us. You are still leading us to the truth found in your word and the truth about your magnificent Son, Jesus. And we thank you. In his name we pray. Amen. Welcome, Ruth.
Thanks, Mark. Well, as you've heard, we're hearing about the environment today, and I've invited a friend of mine to tell us a bit about the environment in our local area. So can we roll the video, please?
Hello there. I'm Davina Attenbergs, and I'm here at Lake Ironbark at the ponds to have a look at the environment here and see what we can learn.
These gorgeous creatures are baby swans, also known as cygnets. Here's Mum coming over just to check on their safety.
This is a duck.
And this is another duck.
And this is what happens when you don't duck.
Sometimes our environments get affected by bushfire and smoke, as you can see in this image here. Unfortunately, this is just an image. Oh, speaking of image. This is a swamp hen building her nest for her young ones. She's planning to lay some eggs soon, and we'll see some chicks arrive in a few weeks. And here is another species in its natural environment, creating a nest for itself. I'm not sure that this one is planning to lay eggs. I think it's just planning to lay down. Come with me, I'm going to show you a very special little community of creatures. We have a mob of kangaroos, a flock of seagulls, a murder of crows, but come and have a look at these interesting creatures. This is what we call a stirring of spoons, but there's a fine line between art and rubbish. Come and have a look at this. This is what we call a littering of rubbish. And here we are at a picnic in a local park, and here is one of the local species choosing to use a pink plastic plate rather than the environmentally friendly plates. There's another creature that's quite misunderstood. It's green with a yellow head, and it does need to be fed.
But we need to be extremely careful about what we feed it.
I hope you've learnt something about how special and how important our environment is, and how important it is to be looking after God's good earth. Please take care of what God has created and given us the responsibility to care for. Bye for now, boys and girls.
Thanks, Davina. People say we look alike, but I don't see it myself. We're looking at the environment and what it's, and that it's about looking after God's earth and our responsibility to take care of it. So I just want to read you something from the Bible, from Genesis 1, which says, "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and rule over it.'" When God made the earth, it was good. And when he made us, it was very good. He gave us a special role to be like him and rule over the earth that he made. But we need to always make sure that he still rules over us and that we obey him. Part of obeying God is to make sure that we take care of his creation. And this includes the environment and each other. We do need to be careful, though, that we don't turn looking after the environment or looking after the earth into worshipping the earth. There is a difference. It is important to look after the earth, but it should never become more important than following and obeying Jesus. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us this beautiful earth and the responsibility of looking after it. Help us to look after it well, to look after each other, and to always put you first. Amen.
Thank you for that wonderful kid spot. Now we have a time of prayer, and I'm going to invite Mary and Paul Collis from our Marsden Park congregation to lead us in prayer. But before they do that, I've got a question for them, and it is, what have you both missed most while you have been in lockdown?
Well, I think... Mark, that I think seeing people face to face is what we've missed. Zoom just doesn't do it for us.
Yep.
And I think for me, the thing I've missed the most has been congregational singing. I've tried to sing along with the services, and I think Paul's getting a bit sick of hearing that. I can't wait to be back at church praising God with everyone else.
Yes. Well, hopefully soon we'll be back, and then I think we have to wait a little bit longer till we'll be able to sing, but we're very, very hopeful that will be around the first week of December and things will start to feel a bit like they were before lockdown. So I'll hand it over to you guys and you can lead us in prayer. Thank you very much.
Okay, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the great love you have for us. Thank you that Jesus lived as our example and died as our Saviour, paying the penalty for our sins that we might have life and life more abundantly. Thank you that we can trust you with every aspect of our lives, and we lift up those who are in need at this time and pray that those needs may be met in you. We pray that they would be encouraged to seek you in their time of need. Teach us today as we hear your word. I pray we would have ears to hear and receptive hearts to receive the word of God, which is able to save our souls. Give us strength in this age, Lord, where godly values are often compromised, and help us to honour you in word and deed, to be strong in our faith and not bound up by the cares of this life, to walk in humility, trusting you in all things. We pray for our new state premier and all who are in leadership in this country, that they would lead with wisdom and righteousness. And we pray that they would lead with a desire for good outcomes and bring blessing to our nation. We pray for our church leadership, that you would give them a spirit of wisdom and greater revelation in the knowledge of you, that they would be blessed with every spiritual blessing. We pray that they would be fruitful, would abound in fruitfulness and be encouraged and strengthened as they lead us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Lord, we're very happy to be at the end of this long lockdown. But even as we prepare to move out of it tomorrow, we thank you for all you've done in our lives because of these restrictions. Even though we've struggled in various ways, we've also learned some patience, and we've discovered that many of the things we thought were important are actually not of great consequence in the larger scheme of things. We've learned better to value each other and to appreciate the love and care of the local body of Christ. We have known that we are not alone, and there is always someone to reach out to, and so many in our state do not have that solace. We have realised how great is the blessing of assembling together, because we've had so much time without that. And most of all, we've come to see that you, Jesus, are never locked down, and that your word has not been, never has been, nor ever will be chained in any way. We praise you for the sermons we've heard during the lockdown that have lifted our spirits and filled us with courage, and for the extra time we've had to study your word, and for the opportunities within our church to continue to meet in small groups online to encourage one another in the knowledge of our great God. We pray as we come out of this time of rest in many ways that we'll hit the ground full of zeal and joy to bless our neighbours and friends with the good news of Jesus our Lord. Please give us hearts of love for those we meet and wisdom on how to reach out to them with the gospel. We ask that they will see our peace in a time when many have fear and worry. May your word spread far and wide in this next season. We ask you that unity would reign in our churches, and we will continue, all would continue to be welcomed and included, and that different ideas brought out in this pandemic would become less important under the unity that we have in you, Jesus. We ask that our churches will be oases, separated from the division and misunderstandings rife in our larger society, that they will be beacons of truth as we stand together more than ever, developing our practices, not from secular culture, but from you, our Heavenly Father, who made all things, to whom we will give account. We ask for wisdom for parents with children returning to school to help them adjust to the new ways of doing things calmly. And we pray as families that we would exhibit trust in you, our Heavenly Father. And as we move through this time when COVID moves from being a pandemic to becoming endemic, we acknowledge that you hold every day of our lives in your hands and that nothing happens to your children without your assent. And this gives us peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We have now a time of a short break for you at home. Can I encourage you, if you haven't got your Bible there or you've opened your little app on your device, can you do that as we prepare for the Bible reading and also the sermon? Because as I said earlier, this topic is about looking at God's word, not what the world says. So we want you to focus on God's word yourself at home if you can do that. And the other thing is, if you need to settle your children, please do that, and we will see you back in about 4 minutes' time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Welcome back, friends, and I just want to say good morning to you. I just want to remind people, or also thank people for your generosity in supporting our church in your weekly giving or monthly giving, and it matters so much to keep the ministries of our church going, and particularly those who give online, it makes it so much easier. And there we see the link there at the bottom of the screen. Well, I want to say thank you for those people who have filled in those surveys over the last couple of weeks. They have been so helpful for us as we consider how we're going to come back to church and all the issues involved. And we're pulling out every stop we can to make church a safe place and a good place as we gather face to face. It's encouraging to see that New South Wales is 73% fully vaccinated. Actually, the suburbs immediately in our parish are over 97% vaccination. And we're told that on the 18th of October, New South Wales will reach 80%. It's a great milestone. Well, we are anticipating coming back to church in a gradual way. And we just want to make sure it's gradual and people can take their time and stay at home, and when you feel comfortable, you can come back to church face to face. And to that end, next Sunday morning at 9:30 will be the last of our Life United streamed services. So what does that look like? Well, we can come back if you're vaccinated for those services, and it will be streamed at Quakers Hill. And so you're welcome to come along to that 9:30 service. Those who are members of the Quakers Hill congregation, come back to there and be part of that congregation as it's streamed. Of course, we're wanting the services to be part of Life United, and so we have live screening congregations at Riverston and at Marsden Park at 9:30 next Sunday morning. And of course, you'll need to be vaccinated to attend those services. But we are prioritising those who are at home who just want to take their time returning to church. So these are, you know, engaging times, and I look forward to you and connecting with you in that special way. Well, we're going to hear from Mark about streaming local church services.
Thank you, Jeff. Yes, I'm talking probably about step one. So God willing, that occurs around Sunday, the 24th of October. And we still believe at that point it will be the 70% double vaccinated rule. So again, unfortunately, not everyone will be able to come back to church in that way. So what we are doing is we're prioritising live streams. And what changes? Well, every campus has a live stream that day. And if you are double vaccinated, you are welcome to be part of the studio audience that day. Or alternatively, you can obviously watch at home. So that's the 24th of October. You can see the information there on your screen. And there will be some children's activities. There won't be the full children's program, but there will be some children's activities. So the family is welcome, if the parents are double vaccinated, to come. But we, again, are prioritising the live streams at each service. So hopefully you enjoy that, and we look forward to seeing you face to face. And I'll hand it over to Daniel to talk about the 31st.
Thanks, Mark. Just before we jump into that, there is a question online about whether you have to register or let us know that you're coming for those services. The answer is no. We have enough room for people to come along that would like to, and we will do the social distancing, 4 square meter rules. That's all being factored in, but you don't need to actually register to come to either the live studio congregation or the live screenings. There will not be screamings at those services, or at least that's the goal. let me tell you about the last sign. It's a couple of weeks away now, but you see on the screen there, it says COVID-safe congregations. That is not to say we're not going to be COVID-safe before that point, but on the 31st of October, it's expected that both vaccinated and unvaccinated people are allowed to be back at church together. And so we want to embrace that and offer that opportunity. I do want to say, I feel like this is going to be a stage for us that will have some trickiness to it as people wrestle with the spectrum of how we feel about vaccinations and unvaccinated and what that looks like, what it looks like for children and kids ministry. We're working all that out. We're working as hard as we can to be COVID safe. I want to say on top of that, that we need to be a community of love and grace with each other as we navigate this. I think it's really important that we are not people that are vilifying people that are not yet vaccinated or have concerns about vaccination, but that we are loving and accepting community. We take every precaution we can. With that said, I would like to say if you are still waiting to get vaccinated, that is you desire to, but you're on the many waiting lists that are around, we'd encourage you to continue waiting that little bit longer. Wait till you're fully vaccinated before you join us face to face. We love you. We want to be with you. We want to see everyone. We want to do that as safely as we can. So, and we look forward to a day when that is completely possible. And December, we can do that and sing, which is super exciting. So I'm going to pass back to Mark and we'll head into our Bible teaching time.
Thank you, Daniel. I'm going to invite Lionel up now and just to get to know him a little bit better. Good to see you, Lionel.
Great to see you, Mark. Great to be here.
I think it feels like it's been a while in the making of getting you to come and preach at our services. You're very in demand and we finally got you. We didn't know what was going to happen because of lockdown or whatever, but you're here, which is fantastic.
Great
and you'll
to be
able
here.
To obviously preach to our many congregations. Can you tell us a bit about yourself? Your family, firstly?
Yes, yep. I'm married to Bronwyn, and we have three teenagers, Adelaide and Harry and Ellie.
Excellent. And where do you live at the moment?
Yeah, so we live in Newtown. I actually grew up in the Hawkesbury, but we live in Newtown in the middle of the city. I'm there with my family. I'm a lecturer at Moore College.
Excellent. And yeah. What does that involve, being a lecturer? What do you do? You just tell people stuff about the Bible and...
it's actually teaching and training people in Christian ministry. So there's all sorts of things that we do. There's a pastoral role with students. There's getting involved in some missions, which has been a little bit different over the time of lockdown and that sort of thing. But also I teach New Testament. So I teach Mark's Gospel, Romans, various pastoral epistles, various other things.
Excellent.
As well,
yep.
Which is really great.
And I know that you have a website that has lots of fantastic articles. Can you tell us that website so if the people at home want to have a look and see a bit more information?
Go for it, lionelwindsor.net. The topic I'm speaking on today has some resources on the environment. The book is God Green, but there's a whole lot of other things there as well. And I think there's a slide at the end of my talk if you want to follow that up. So
that's fantastic. Well, we look forward to hearing from you very, very soon.
Look forward to it. Thanks,
excellent.
Mark. Great.
All right, guys, sorry about that technical difficulty. And I'm going to read the Bible. And so we have a few readings today. Okay, so we've got Genesis 1, 26 to 28. We have Genesis 2, 15 to 17. And Genesis 3, 17 to 19. And you're going to have to bear with me as well because I'm actually looking up these Bible readings and running while we're on the ground. So be patient with me too. All right, Genesis 1, verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. fill the earth and subdue it, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. We're now going to go to Genesis 2, verses 15 and 17. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden." And 17 is, "But you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." And we're going to go to Genesis 3, 17 and 19. Sorry, just finding the reading. 17 to 19. To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat fruit from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field." And then we actually have a couple of New Testament readings. We're going to go to Colossians 1, 15 to 23. Oh, I've got to find Colossians. Which could be interesting, because this is not my Bible. I know it's all in the same place. My husband's being very helpful. And all the pages are stuck together because it's a new book as well. Why can't someone just get me it for me, hey? Okay, Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 to 20. "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body and the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all the fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." And also Colossians 3, verses 5 to 10. "Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, pure desires and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator." Praise the Lord, because I had no glasses on.
Reminder of how wonderful face-to-face fellowship is, but also how amazing the various tech people are. And this is the same is true at Moore College, where our tech teams are doing all sorts of things to just get everything out there. Thanks, Melissa, and thanks, everybody. Why don't we, as we approach God's word, let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the opportunity that we do have to hear your word, even over the technology that we have that is itself not perfect. And Father, we thank you that you have given us your word. And we do pray now that you would settle us and help us to see the wonder and beauty of the Lord Jesus, and help us to know what your word has to say about this world and this creation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, greetings to you all from Moore College. It's really wonderful to be able to speak to you today, despite these hard circumstances of lockdown. And the topic that we're looking at today is humanity and creation. Of course, the most obvious issue right now in our world that this brings to mind is climate change, isn't it? As reports have come out, etc. We keep hearing statistics, we keep hearing dire warnings. The scientists are very concerned. So to quote from the Australian Academy of Science in Canberra, which is a significant organisation here in Australia, global emissions are not estimated to peak by even 2030. Global sea level rise is accelerating, seawater is becoming more acidic, Arctic summer sea ice has declined by around 12% per decade since 1979, ice lost annually from the Antarctic ice sheet increased at least sixfold between 1979 and 2017, heat waves were the deadliest meteorological hazard between 2015 and 2019, affecting all continents. Recent rises in temperature are a key driver for global hunger due to higher than normal drought conditions around the world, including Australia. There's been huge growth in renewable energy, but fossil fuel sources still dominate global energy systems. And as you hear these things, I wonder how you're feeling about them. Are you feeling perhaps anxious or fearful? Perhaps you're feeling resigned. Maybe you're feeling really skeptical about these things. Maybe you're feeling hopeful. There's a lot of different feelings about climate change and other things as well, aren't there? These environmental issues. And personally, I'm really thankful for the scientists and individuals and organisations who are seeking solutions about climate change. But sometimes it's hard to see those solutions, and sometimes you can even feel a bit like despairing. So that's why I'm convinced we need to keep our eyes on the big picture. The big picture. Even the Australian Academy of Science knows that we need more than science. Here's what they say in an informational brochure. They say that decisions are informed by climate science, but fundamentally involve ethics and value judgments. Choices hinge on ethical frameworks and value judgments about the well-being of people, economies, and the environment. What are they saying? They're saying, well, if we want to know what to decide what to do, we need more than the science. We actually need a big picture. We need a framework of values to make sense of the world, to know why we should care. And that's what I'm speaking to you briefly about today. Have you heard of Sir John Horton? He died last year, aged 88. He actually died from COVID-19 complications. Horton was a climate scientist. Not just any old climate scientist, but he was foundational in establishing the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. He led its Working Group 1 from 1988 to 2002. And Horton's scientific work was driven by his Christian views. So he said in an interview, "Putting my science and faith alongside each other has always been important to me because I believe they belong together. The most important choice I've made is to accept Jesus as my Saviour and Lord." So now I want us to see briefly what drove Sir John Horton and many Christians. I want to share what the Bible teaches about the big picture of our world. We're going to look at some of the key things the Bible says about God, about humanity, and about the world, because I'm convinced that even in the bad news that goes around, there is wonderful good news for us and for our world. So we'll start with the opening chapters of the Bible. We had read Genesis chapters 1 and 2, and these chapters tell us some fundamental things about God and humanity and the world, very relevant for how we treat the world. Some key points. Firstly, the world is not the same as God. The first verse of the Bible says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." So God was there before the world was made. He's in control and he chose to make this world. And so that means we don't worship the world as if that's all that matters. And we don't worship the world just as if the world itself is God. That's the first thing. Secondly, the world is good. In Genesis, whenever God makes something, he says it is good. He looks at the seas, the trees, the animals, the fish he's made, and God saw that it was good. God loves what he's made, and that means the world matters. It matters to us. This world around us matters to God, as we saw in the children's talk. The ducks, they're good. Genesis 1:26. The third point is about you and me, men and women. We have a special place in the world. The Bible says we're made in the image of God. Yes, we're part of the world, but we have a special place in it because we have a special relationship with God. We also have a special relationship to the world itself. We are the rulers of the world. Our God-given job is to rule the world. Now, when I say the word rule, maybe it sounds really harsh and horrible to you. Maybe you think I'm saying that God has given us the world to dominate, to bash into shape for our own purposes. But no, that's not what the Bible says at all. Now, of course, if you think God doesn't matter, then you might end up thinking that the world is just there for your own selfish purposes. After all, that is actually what a lot of 20th century atheist dictatorships ended up doing. And it's been a disaster. But no, according to the Bible, we have to remember that we are, yes, ruling God's creation, but it's a world that God has made. It is God's creation, and God believes it is good. It's not just good for you and me, just to serve our purposes and desires. It's good for God, and it was good even before we came along. That's why the Bible describes our task this way. The Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. There's two aspects here to our rule of God's creation, to work and keep the world. So there's work. Work is good. We're not just supposed to be passive caretakers of the world, to actively work. That's why industry, business, all those things, they're not just some evil thing that we have to get rid of. Work is good, especially when it's used to serve other humans. But of course, as we do our work, we need to remember that we have a responsibility to care for our world, that is, to keep it. Ruling isn't about taking for our own ends. It's about giving and serving. It's about serving God, who made the good world, serving each other by working, and even serving God's world itself by taking care of it. And that's why Christians have a reason to care deeply about environmental issues, including climate change. I studied and worked a number of years ago in solar energy. My thesis supervisor at uni and my boss was in that area was called Professor Stuart Wenham. And he was actually a giant in worldwide solar cell research. He's been very big behind all sorts of solar cell industry areas and research. And he was also a Christian. Here's a quote from Stuart Wenham about why he did research. He said, "For the challenge of using science and technology to try and make this world that God has given us a better place, not only for those less well off, but also for the sake of future generations through the preservation of our environment." So there's Stuart Wenham. Sadly, has passed away now. But that is a quote from him that shows that is what he was doing. Okay, so that's what the Bible says about the ideal relationship between God and humanity and the world. But if you know anything about the Bible, and with those Bible readings, we saw that there's more to the story, isn't there? There's more to the story. The next chapter's not nearly so happy. I think we all know it, don't we? There's something terribly and tragically wrong with our world. So Genesis chapter 3 describes how humanity, God's rulers, the people made in God's image, actually rebelled against God. Well, they said no to God. They didn't do what God intended with their own lives. They didn't do what God intended with the world. They thought they could run the world and their own lives, you know, just by themselves. And that's relevant to all of us because we all rebel against God too in our own lives in different ways. And that's true for all of us. God cares about what we've done. He cares enough indeed to judge us. So Genesis chapter 3, God issues what is effectively a death sentence for humanity, culminating in those ominous words. Did you hear them? "For you are dust, and to dust you shall return." It's a death sentence that affects all of us, and it has eternal consequences. We will indeed face God's judgment. And it also has consequences for us and for our world and for our relationship to the world. That's what God says about the relationship between humanity and creation. Genesis chapter 3, "Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. By the sweat of your face, you shall eat bread. You see, the Bible is realistic about our world. We are, in some ways, living in a state of sort of fight and struggle against the world that God has, well, with the world God's made. And that's because we, those made in the image of God, have decided that we're not going to act as the image of God. Instead, we're going to try to rule our own way. We're going to try to do what's right and wrong according to our own way of doing things instead of what God says. And that's what the Bible calls sin. And when God's image bearers sin, we fail to rule the world. And the world that we're supposed to rule is cursed. And that's why environmental disasters, including climate change, but a whole lot of other things as well, they're not just morally neutral. They can't be separated from sin. The sins simply of greed, for example, haste, wanting more and more stuff, not caring about the consequences for others. That's a big part of the reason behind some of the runaway climate change that the scientists talk about. But it's something that we all do. Because you can't just go and blame those big, bad, evil corporations out there. We all, the world's rulers, God's image bearers, have turned our backs on God. Not living for him, living for ourselves, worshipping what we can get out of the world. And as a result, we're greedy, we lie. This is a disaster for our world and for our environment. So what's the answer? What's the solution? Well, the Bible says it's actually all about Jesus. You can't say anything truly biblical about the environment unless you talk about Jesus. So that's why we had those readings from Colossians. Colossians chapter 1 in the New Testament. He, Jesus Christ, is, did you see it? The image of the invisible God. The firstborn, that is the ruler, over all creation. For by him all things were created. In heaven and on earth. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether in earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. So according to the Bible, who is the true image of God? Who is the human being who rules rightly? Actually, the only one who fits the description is Jesus. Jesus is the human who never rejected God. Jesus always lived for God. Jesus rules the world rightly, God's way. Jesus hasn't just left the rest of us to our fate. He's actually entered into our suffering. He's God's Son who's become one of us in our death-bound world. And even though we are by ourselves under God's death sentence, Jesus took that death on himself, even though he didn't deserve it. He suffered and died instead of us, in our place. He took the curse of death on himself. And what's more, Jesus is risen from the dead. And he gives us life and freedom and forgiveness. I need to say, if you trust this man, Jesus, that he died for you, that he'll restore your relationship with God, he will restore your humanity, he'll restore your dignity, restore your life, make you a child of God. He'll forgive you for turning your back on God and all the horrible ugliness that flows from your sin. He'll forgive you and bring an end to your judgment and give you life forever. And that's why we can't come to grips with what the Bible tells us about the world until we know Jesus, the one who rules that world. But if you do know Jesus, and if you do know that he died and rose from the dead for you, Jesus actually has huge ramifications for your life, and not just for your private life, but also for the way that you treat God's world. See, it says in Colossians that Jesus' death on the cross reconciles all things to God. That means that it brings everything back into its proper relationship with God. And how does it do that? Well, part of the answer is that Jesus' death and his resurrection means that there's a whole new group of human beings who are right with God, people who've had their sins forgiven, who are secure, who can call God their loving Father, people who have a reason to live rightly in the world without the need to live selfishly, because we've got that security already in Jesus. And so we can be people who try each day to put an end to our old way of life. Now, what's that got to do with the environment? What's it got to do with climate change? We'll take greed. We read that in Colossians chapter 3. Greed is about loving and desiring and lusting after the things of this world rather than loving God himself. Greed makes you busy too, actually. If you're really greedy and you need more money, and to get more money, you need to get bigger stuff and more card, get a bigger car or a nicer house or a nicer phone. Greedy people think of their own pleasure first and are very often busy. But people who follow Jesus have a reason to act differently, to think more about how God wants us to act towards the people of the world he's made rather than what we can just get out of it ourselves. So if we know Christ, in every day, even in the little things, we should be putting greed to death. Because we've got Jesus, we've got forgiveness, we've got life. We don't need to run and grasp after all of these things in this world. We can act as people, therefore, in the image of God. We've got the reason to do what is right, care for others, care for our world. We can have that joyful hope, even in suffering, because we know that God's in control. And Jesus teaches us to love our neighbours. And the command to love your neighbour, it's not just a small thing. There's actually a really wide sense to that command, a sense that bursts through the boundaries we like to set up about exactly who our neighbour is. Part of loving our neighbour is therefore caring for our world, doing the right thing for the world and for others, doing the right thing with what you buy and what you wear and what you throw away and all of those things. And part of that would involve, when you can, supporting people in groups who are trying to do the right thing and praying for our politicians to do the right thing. And I know that people disagree about exactly what the right thing is in terms of the politics and the economics, and that is true. But still, we should care, shouldn't we? Even as we have discussions about, well, exactly how should you do it, we should still care for our world, shouldn't we? And so what about the future? Because I know that's a real worry, isn't it? The Bible doesn't give us any exact details about climate change. The Bible doesn't tell us exactly how many degrees the climate's going to warm by in the next few decades. But the Bible does tell us some very important things about the future of the world that are deeply relevant. And there are two key things that I briefly want to share with you. The first way the Bible speaks about what will happen to our world is judgment. God won't let this world go on forever the way it is. He set a day when he'll judge the world. There's a day of reckoning for all of us. So here's the Apostle Peter. He says, the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar. The heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done in it will be exposed. What's that all about? It's just saying that our sin against God means that humanity is under a sentence of death. And it's so serious that the only way to finally make it right is through serious judgment, which includes our world. And that's what God promises to do. And there are two ways you can face God's judgment. The first way is to face God by yourself. And if you don't know and trust the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll stand before God alone. And he will judge your life. And that's not good news for me. I know that. But if you trust in Jesus, and I trust in Jesus, then you don't face God alone. You face God as somebody with Jesus, who's been forgiven completely by Jesus, whose image has been renewed, whose curse has been lifted. And so you can be confident and secure about the future. The second way the Bible describes the future of the world is renewal. The second last chapter of the Bible, it says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. They'll be his people. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Isn't that a beautiful picture? It's a great hope. It's a great hope as we face COVID. It's a great hope as we face this news that we keep hearing. And in case you had the wrong idea, our hope in the future isn't a new creation. Not just an eternal, boring fluffiness, but our future is that great existence in that new creation, in a renewed, joyful world, living in relationship with God himself. That's what Christians live for. That gives us a reason, therefore, to love and care for the world now. We don't just sort of look forward to this world and say, oh, okay, well, that just gives us a reason to not care. It actually gives us a reason to care, because our world will be renewed, because God cares about what we do. and we will have that great future. Judgment is not the end for us. That's what we hope for. That gives us confidence. We don't despair. It's not as if we carry the burden all by ourselves. God's in control. There's real hope, real hope. And we can look forward to God's new creation forever. And that's why today we can start living for our home even now, putting greed to death and loving our neighbour. Well, thanks very much for your time now. There's a lot more that you might want to think of. I've got some resources. They're going to be up on the slide, and there might be access to them a little bit later. But there's some resources to follow up. I'm going to pray now, and then we'll finish up. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the world that you have made. Father, we thank you for the forgiveness that we have in Jesus, because we know that we ourselves and by ourselves have rejected you. Father, please help us to look to Jesus, to trust in Jesus, to know him. And Father, help us to live in confidence, faith and hope and love in this world that you have given us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks. Thanks for that reminder, Lionel, that I am a child of God, and we are children of God. We get a chance to sing about that now. Over to you, Mark.
get that mask off to finish. Friends, it's wonderful that you could join us today for our online church. Friends, just to make sure that you're aware that church in some way is back on next week. There is a live stream that's happening at the Quakers Hill campus at 9:30, and that will be streamed to here at Riverston and also to the big screen under the Kohler at Marsden Park. In those services, there will be some activities for children. They'll be limited, but please check your emails during the week to see what's happening there at your local congregation. So all the information is actually really clear in church life. So if you don't get that at the moment, you might want to tell our church office, which is office@lifeac.org.au, and be added to that list. So church is back on in a limited sense for those who are double vaccinated, but we are prioritising the live stream, and you can watch it at home. That would be fantastic. Or if you want to come to one of our campuses, you can do that as well. Well, what a treat that we've had today. It's not just, you know, environmental issue, that issues we need to focus on. It's actually Jesus first. And I think we've heard that today, haven't we? That we need to look to the King of the world to help us to understand what's going on in our own lives, but also help us to understand what's going on around us. And one of the things that obviously is spoken about lots is environmental issues. But we don't want to be people who idolize the environment. We want to be people who follow Jesus. Follow Jesus because he is the King and Savior of the world. Follow him because he has done everything for us and continues to do everything for us. I don't know if you heard those Colossians passages when they were read, but it was, I really want to actually end on Colossians chapter 1, just the first 15 and 16. I love these verses, and I think we should hear them again before we close. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, for everything was created by him in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things hold together. What fantastic words. I am so thankful that the triune God of the universe is in complete control. And as Lionel finished up, yes, he will judge, but he will also renew. And we put our hope not in environmental science, but in Jesus. Friends, let me pray before we close. Father God, we do thank you so, so, so much for your Son, Jesus. We thank you for what he has done for us by dying on the cross, by forgiving us, by wiping our slate clean, but not only doing that, actually giving us righteousness, making us right with God. Father God, we thank you so much for Jesus. And we thank you that he didn't just remain dead, but no, he is the risen Lord. He is seated on high. He is controlling all things. He is allowing his grace to flow out. Father God, we just thank you so much for Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.